So next topic is Jallikattu protest. So how this is a new social movement, how there is a contradiction between the forces of tradition and the forces of modern. That is what is to be noted down. The cultural tradition is coming into contradiction with the demands of modernity. We know that when modernity is entering a traditional society, then it will try to blunt the distinctions present in the culture. Modernity is enforcing modernity. We are talking about how tradition and modern are trying to conflict with each other. When modern agents, when the values of modernity is entering into a traditional society, it will try to dilute the cultural distinctiveness. Culture wanted distinctiveness, whereas modernity wanted similarity. So distinctiveness versus similarity. Modern value system speaks about the animal rights, but tradition is that Jallikattu is a sport, a cultural sport. And that is the reason why we said that Jallikattu protest is only a challenge between the forces of tradition and the forces of modernity. We have spoken about in the class about new social movement. New social movement means a movement which is not just asking about the right of the people, it is also asking about the right of animals. PETA is a new social movement. That this new social movement is coming into contradiction with the cultural tradition of the society, and that is what is the main point to be noted down. A new social movement called PETA is coming into sharp contradiction with the culture of the society called as Jallikattu. Next topic is the farmer suicide in Vidarbha and how the women or the widow of the farmer suicide, who committed suicide, is neglected. So a state of, they are living in a state of neglect. The widows of the farmer who committed suicide, they are living in a state of neglect. A study was conducted in Vidarbha region by Kota Nilima. In this study, it was found that how the state is indifferent to the widows of the farmers who committed suicide. These widows are invisible. They are invisible not only to the state but also even to the community. So they are suffering from a number of hardship because of the loss of the head of the family who becomes the, who are the primary breadwinner of the family. So their vulnerability is getting exposed. Women's vulnerability is getting exposed because of the death of the husband. We are living in a patriarchal society. In the traditional society, after the death of the husband, the women will have to commit sati. But now the woman is pushed into the economic hardships. She is subjected to discrimination. She is ostracized. She is alienated. And this is a new form of sati which women are facing today, that more deprivation after the death of the husband. National Crime Record Bureau data says that Maharashtra reported the highest number of farm suicide, especially in the Vidarbha region. So highest suicide rate is in Vidarbha region in Maharashtra. There are many reasons for this farmer suicide. You can add these points in agrarian unrest in paper 2, agrarian social structure in paper 2, farmers movement in paper 2, and also you can speak about relevance of Marxism to Indian society, where necessarily you will have to speak about how capitalism has killed the backbone, it has broken the backbone of the Indian agricultural structure. What are the problems which farmers are facing in Vidarbha? The study was conducted and they found that loan waiver is not a solution at all. Loan waiver is only temporal. The main problem is the institutional loan which they are taking is very less. Their access to institutional credit is very less. And most of the time they have taken from the money lenders, private money lenders. So waiver, loan waiver is not a solution. Right? So it cannot be a permanent solution. Lack of irrigation, fragmentation of land, and low access to credit. So these are the chronic problems, these are the chronic problems present in agriculture. Fragmentation of land, low access to credit, and lack of irrigation facilities. So these chronic issues will have to be addressed, not just a cosmetic attempts like a loan waiver, right? So the first point we have spoken about, rather than addressing to the chronic issues of fragmentation of land or access to capital or lack of irrigation, just a single stroke of loan waiver is not going to solve the problem. The second issue is that the cotton seed, BT cotton seed, which was very costly. Monsanto company was selling the cotton seed at a price, say 2000 rupees per kilogram, when the indigenous cotton seed was available for 100 rupees per kilogram. So increasing cost of agriculture, increased input cost, this resulted in deepening of indebtedness. Increased input cost resulting in deepening of indebtedness. Next point is the state's denial and distrust of the farmer suicide. The state is denying the fact called farmer suicide. So complete state denial, they are denying the fact of farmer suicide. So state denial. And fourthly, blaming on the habit of the farmers. So it is said that the farmers are the reasons for their poverty. So it is not the failure of the state that manifested in the form of farmer suicide. Rather, it is because of the individual incapability that they committed suicide. So it is the individual problem, not the problem of the system. So this is showing the apathy towards the plight of the farming community. So state is denying the fact that there is a farmer suicide, and also all blames are put on the farmers themselves, as it is an incapacity which is causing suicide, not because of the failure of the state. Census says women headed households, they accounted for 10% of rural households. So when a farmer is committing suicide in the rural areas, what will happen to the family? It will become female-headed households. Some 10% of the families are female-headed households according to census 2011 in rural areas. Next is mobilization of people in Vidarbha. So we have seen how when there is a deprivation, when there is a discrimination, when there is a sense of disenchantment, that will throw protest. How farmers are mobilizing themselves in Vidarbha, a study conducted by Nikit Kumar Agarwal. Of course, democracy involves collective protest or collective actions of the people. So this you can write in collective action, which is present in the 7th unit of paper 1. Polity and society or political system. There is a topic called as collective mobilization. Collective mobilization is an integral part of democracy. Why collective mobilization? Collective mobilization is because people are not happy with the present. Dissent, disapproval, and dissatisfaction with the present is throwing movement. So they wanted to bring a transformation, not just social but also political transformation. All collective mobilizations are wanting change. They are change oriented movements. So they are political movements or social movements. If you look at Telangana, in case of Telangana, sustained movement since 1940s resulted in the creation of 29th state in 2014. But there was also Vidarbha movement for a very long period of time. But however, despite of increasing farmer suicide, Vidarbha movement is not getting intensivity. It is not able to attract more people in comparison to the Telangana movement. So Telangana movement was a successful movement because what was the aim of the movement? Creation of a new state called Telangana. But Vidarbha movement is not able to get the number of participants despite of the fact that there is an increasing case of farmer suicide. So Vidarbha movement is older than Telangana movement, but however it has become very dormant. Vidarbha movement is more older than Telangana movement, but it has become dormant in the last 15 years. Ranajit Guha speaks about insurgencies. There is a topic called as identity based movements in Social Movements paper 2. You can link social movements, protest, collective action present in Polity and Society, unit number 7 in paper 1, with that of the social movements present in paper 2. Right? What Ranajit Guha speaks about is insurgency is rooted in the colonial past. It is a creation of the colonial administrators. So insurgency is tracing its root in the colonial administration. Despite of colonial administrators leaving India, that there is a continuation of the insurgency. There is a continuation of Naxalism, Tebaga movement, as well as Telangana movement. Farmers' protest, speaking about the rising consciousness of the new agricultural community. Because we thought that with the rise of industrialization and the transformation of the economic system going in the lines of capitalism, that farmers will lose their identity and people will shift to the industrial sector. But India, unlike in Western societies, 60% of people are still dependent on agriculture directly or indirectly. So there is a renewal of the agrarian identity today. Rather than dissipation of the agrarian identity, there is a renewal of the agrarian identity. And this is becoming a new phenomena which is manifesting in the form of a number of contemporary farmers' movement in India today. You can look at the syllabus, social movements, rural agrarian transformation, relevance of Marxism in India. These are the areas where you can write the updated or the value additions which we are making. Mansoor protest in Madhya Pradesh, June 2017. What are the demands which the farmers have made in this protest 2017? They wanted increasing MSP. They wanted the recommendation of Swaminathan committee to be implemented. And farmers organization from across many states, they came in support of the Mansoor farmers. So from Punjab, from Maharashtra, UP, Rajasthan, many farmers organization, they started supporting the Mansoor farmers. The Mansoor farmers, are they becoming class war itself? Because Karl Marx says, as long as Indian society is practicing agriculture, peasants are non-revolutionary, according to Karl Marx. Peasants are non-revolutionary, they are divided on the basis of caste. So, peasant revolution is not in the scheme of Marxian writing as far as India is concerned. 1960s, Mao attempted peasant revolution. And today you can see the increasing farmers' agitation is indicating to the fact that they have become class for itself rather than class in itself. The agitation, which is getting the support of many of the organizations, has ultimately resulted in the integration of more than 180 farmers association called as All India Kisan Sangharsh Coordination Committee. So more than 180 farmers association, they came together, they had a joint platform in the name called as All India Kisan Sangharsh Coordination Committee. So this is something which is akin to class consciousness. In 1980s and all, farmers movement was led by those who are from middle class. But today farmers movement is led by a number of people. In fact, in many of the cases there is no leader at all, leaderless movement. So instant it becomes, spontaneous it becomes. Today you can see more informed people, more educated people, they are taking up the leadership role. So they are technologically sound, they use WhatsApp, they use social media network to spread the movement. And that is why there was an All India Band which was called by the farmers, right? Which wanted some 10 lakh people to come together to stop the supply of the agricultural produce to the urban counterparts. So a new farmers movement is totally different because it is attracting so many youths, so many informed people using technology. So they are using mass media to get a nationwide support to their farmers movement. There is so much of mixedness present in the farmers movement today, unlike traditional farmers movement, which was having a structure, which was having an organized leadership, which was having a strategy. But today it is having so much of informal component present in the farmers movement. So it is highly decentralized, unlike the centralized farmers movement present before independence. So it is highly decentralized. And the politics is now shifting towards rural India, because rural India, still 70% of the population is present in rural India. The politics is today becoming rural centric. In fact, rural India got disintegrated, the structure of the rural industries got destroyed because of globalization since 1991. And these elements of globalization, which created more insecurity and suffering to the farming community, has only triggered the new farmers movement today. Many have participated, women participated, tribes participated, lower caste people participated, middle caste people participated, educated, uneducated. So this is a mass mobilization actually. And it is not just confined to farmers, it is related to even allied sectors. Not just concerned with farmers' plight, it is also related to the allied sector of farming. So allied agricultural communities are also jumping into this farmers' movement. Gupta says that in 1990s and 1980s, rural as a socio-cultural space was vanishing because more and more urban becomes the dominant space in the politics. So everything, economy and politics, was centering around the urban space in 1980s and 1990s. There was a gross decline of the rural as a socio-cultural space, according to Gupta. But today, you can see, even Reddy and Mr. also said the number of people who are practicing agriculture is reducing. But today you can see that there is a new quest for an identity, a new identity centering around the rural agrarian identity. So number of people taking up farming is reducing. 1980s, 1990s, rural as a socio-cultural space is declining. But today there is a renewed interest in the rural identity. A new rural agrarian identity is getting revisited, it is getting rejuvenated. Right? So identity is not just pertaining to ethnicity. Identity is also pertaining to agriculture. There is an identity based movements in social movements topic. Rural India is today becoming a more socio-cultural space which is dominating the politics. So new rural agrarian agitations, more and more rural questions, more and more agrarian questions are asked, and they are becoming a new future today. So agriculture is getting revived. Identity coming from agriculture is getting revived. Rural areas are becoming major socio-cultural spaces today, and there is a renewed interest in this rural agrarian identity. Right? As we know that more and more, when culture is attacked by modernity, culture will try to rejuvenate. Agriculture is also a culture, a way of living, and that is how the agrarian identity is today getting more and more pronounced. What is the nature of the urban spaces and how it is causing unfilled or unfulfilled aspirations? There is a topic called as urbanization in paper 2, where you have to add these points. What are the negative externalities attached to urbanization? In what way negatively urbanization is causing to the larger society? Urbanization is increasing the cost of living, no doubt about it. Not only that, there is an alienation which the urban community is facing today. Alienation. Lonely crowd. We are in a crowd, but we feel lonely. Reisman writes a book, Lonely Crowd. So urbanization resulted in alienation. In the test batch discussion, we have spoken about culture of poverty, slum culture, subculture, delinquency, and how personality is totally influenced by the urban space, overcrowding, psychological impact. Apart from all these concepts, apart from all these points, we have some extra points like it is causing alienation, exclusion. Individualism is more and more present in urban. Collectivism is more and more present in village. So pattern variable A is present in village. Pattern variable B is present in city. Right? Social isolation, absence of sense of belonging, faster pace of competitive life. Life is becoming very competitive. And those who migrated from villages, they feel completely disillusioned. So people who are coming to urban cities or those who are present in villages, they are migrating because looking at the employment opportunity. So what is happening to the rural youths who have migrated to city? They are facing rootless. They are completely cut off from their own land. So they feel from alienation and disillusionment. More competition, more high speed society it is. So virtual, what is virtual, what is real, the distinction is missing, and that is why these problems are becoming bigger to be studied by sociologists. What is the relation between education and migration? A study conducted by Jyotka 2014, Vasavi 2012 says, access to education is one of the causes of migration. So when they get educated, they come to city for employment. Educational access has triggered migration. Educational access triggered migration. Deepankar Gupta says, an important and necessary condition for being an urbanite or urbanite is education. So he is using a concept called as urbanite. Urbanization was already a concept used by G.S. Gure to speak about the organic linkage between the city and the village, which got broken because of the British administration. So the main condition for being a urbanite is education. And that is why people spend more on education. Today, the out-of-pocket expenditure which the rural people are making is more for education. Because agriculture is declining. The only source of employment is industrial employment, and that too present in the cities. And that is why poor farmers present in village, they are even selling their land for the sake of the education of their children. So rural poor is spending more on education than what they could afford. Next point is changing nature of violence. Because today you have seen that Thoothukudi incident has resulted in a closer scrutiny of how violence is changing. Earlier, violence will be short term. It will be for a short period of time. But today, violence is becoming a very permanent phenomena. In the earlier time, there will be a violence, and this violence will be very short term, and immediately there will be normalcy. Violence, shorter period of time, subsequently normalcy will be established. But today violence is having an institutionalized pattern in the contemporary times. Violence has become an institution. That in the garb of religious festivals, riots are premeditated, arsoning is premeditated, murders are premeditated, right? And there is also more and more support coming from the political system for the violence, using violence, dividing the people, converting the people into vote bank, which is why communalism, religious revivalism present today. There is one topic called as violence against women in paper 2 and agents of social change, social movements. These are the areas where you can write. Multifaceted violence today. Thoothukudi incident is what? Capitalism versus environment, simply. Capitalism versus environment, Thoothukudi incident. Dalit uprising today. Why Dalit uprising? They are experiencing upward mobility. That is why Dalit uprising. And who is not accepting to this upward mobility? Dominant caste, they are not ready to accept the upward mobility of the Dalits, hence caste conflicts. And farmers protest across the country. Women and children are sexually assaulted, and there are increasingly movements to protect the rights of women and children. So these are the new forms of violence. Escalating Dalit assertion, farmers' problem, sexual assault, and the agitation against it. Tradition versus modernity, that type of conflict. Outsider versus insider syndrome, as what is present in Northeast India. And digital movements today. That through information and technology, there is so much of digital wave which is creating new digital movements. So these are new movements which we are seeing today. New types of violence. The agitations today are leaderless. The violence nature is changing. And you can't simply explain the outdated ideas to explain today. You can't simply use the outdated ideas to explain today the changing structure of violence. So new approaches needed, empirical approaches needed because of the multifaceted nature of violence present in today's time. So there is a question on population dynamics we have in paper 2. These are the points present in our syllabus, paper 2. And maternal health. Suresh Jungari in a study found that how men's role is very crucial in the maternal health. International Conference on Population and Development 1994 stressed on participation of men in the maternal health of women. So, husband's role in maternal health was stressed in this International Conference on Population and Development 1994. Which conference it is? Which place? 1994 conference? Huh? Cairo conference, no? Cairo conference. So, in tribal society, whether men are actively participating in the women's maternal health, a study was conducted. Tribes like Gond and Madia of Maharashtra was studied, and these two tribes are very similar tribes, they have similar environment, and whether women were supported by men as far as the maintenance of the maternal health is concerned, this was studied, and they found that they are not aware, men are not aware of the complication which arises during pregnancy, childbirth and postnatal period. Lack of awareness about the problems of women. So, men are not aware of the problems which women will face during childbirth, during pregnancy and during the post-pregnancy periods. Completely, they are not aware of the problems which women are facing. There was a question asked a year back, sociology of reproductive health. Right? So, this area, these points can be used in population dynamics. So, this lack of awareness is negatively affecting the maternal health care. And the research also found that maternal health care is better only in nuclear family compared to joint family. The role of men in maternal health care is more in case of nuclear family, not in joint family. 28% of men in joint family, 52% of men in nuclear family accompanied their wife for the postnatal care. And men took care of women, men took care of the maternal health of women, especially in the love marriages. So, role of men in maternal health of women is the topic. The data says nuclear family, less instances, joint family, more instances of husband's participation in the maternal health of women. So, what are the thing which we have to suggest? Increase the awareness level of the men with respect to maternal health. Because in the tribal society, both are not having awareness about how to plan for the parenthood. Lack of awareness, both in case of men and women, regarding how to plan for parenthood. So, tribal societies are still in the stage of infancy, that they don't have shared responsibility regarding maternal care. They are not having shared responsibility in the maternal care. Why men are not participating in women's health? Because they think that this maternal health is the problem of women, where men have no role to take. So, that is women's issue, not men's issue. And that is why they consistently ignored maternal health of women, saying that it is women's problem. So, what we have to do? Educate them, spread awareness about the need of husband's role in the maternal health of women, counsel them. An article came in the Hindu paper, The Tools of Counting. So caste based census was present only during the British period in 1931. Why they were counting the caste? They were counting the caste to divide us. They are counting us to divide people, to categorize a particular caste group as a homogeneous group, thereby easily manipulate them. Pit one caste against the other caste. So divide and conquer, that is what is their policy. After British went, independent India was not having caste based census because it will be manipulated for political interest. But subsequently, socio-economic caste census 2011 speaks about a varieties, some seven types of deprivation faced by people in the rural areas. First census 1871 itself, questions on caste was asked. Why? Not to develop the caste groups, but to divide and conquer India. What British did? Initially, they promoted Brahmins as interpreters of Indian culture. And subsequently, they told that all the problems, caste-based exploitation, the root cause is Brahmin. So initially, Brahmins were portrayed by British as if they are the interpreters of Indian culture. Subsequently, Brahmins were identified as the root cause for all the caste-related discriminations and inequality. So this is why they counted caste. Veenada says that what colonial census did, colonial census created a conception that caste is a homogeneous group. But actually caste is not a homogeneous group. Within the caste there is present many subcastes, jatis are present. But they conceived this as a homogeneous group. And easily they can classify these homogeneous groups. After India got independent, we did not have any caste based census. But the problem is that you have to rely on the British conception of caste because of the lack of modern counting of the caste. We have to rely on the British data and have British conception of caste. So whether it is state or in fact the government, the parliament or even judiciary, when they wanted to conceive caste, they are taking the conception coming from the British. And that is why there were a need for, there were demands for caste based census. Our political system, civil society and court defined caste based social categories using the 1931 census, which was made during the British period. But since 1931, how many changes we have seen? Look at the nature of changes. Caste system has underwent changes since 1931 till 2011. Land got fragmented. Land ownership is getting diluted. Earlier, upper caste was owning land. Today, the land ownership with respect to the upper caste is coming down. So, land ownership of the upper caste is coming down. Land ownership that bolstered the power of the upper caste has lost its hold. One is, many of the lands are agricultural lands are becoming industrial lands, and also because of the fragmentation of land, more and more lands are small and medium lands, not bigger lands. Fragmentation of land, agricultural stagnation. So dominant castes who are owning the land, they have become marginal farmers because of land fragmentation and agrarian stagnation. Those caste groups which were owning land, today they have become marginal farmers. Landlessness was a bane before, it was a curse, especially for the Dalits. Today landlessness is an opportunity for you. You can take advantage of the rural wages. You can go to construction industry. If you are having land, you cannot come out of the land. If you don't have land today, multiple opportunities are present, especially in the cities. So easily you can come. So So those who are owning land, they are confining themselves to the villages. Those who don't own land, they are coming to the cities, getting into all types of occupations. According to NSS data, bottom fourth of the farmer caste are poorer than the top half of the Dalits. National sample survey data says bottom fourth of the forward caste are poorer than the top half of the Dalits. Indian Human Development Survey says 56% of the Dalit children between 8 to 11 age group, they cannot read, they are unable to read, they are illiterate, uneducated. 32% of the forward caste and 47% of the OBC children also are unable to read between age group 8 to 11. So which means that children are not having education even in the forward caste as well as OBC caste. 56% of Dalit children, they are not able to read. 47% of OBC children, they are not able to read. 32% of forward community children, they are not able to read. So which means that the status of forward caste is getting declined. The power which they were having to bolster because of the economic status, this is also reducing due to the fragmentation and other problems. Now what politicians are doing? They are trying to exploit the relative deprivation faced by the caste groups. And we don't have new data. We are using the old data and we are having the same conception as that of the British. And that is why there was a demand for caste-based census. Without current data, our discourse on caste and affirmative action, that is reservation, will remain dominated by the decisions made by the colonial administration. So hence only they wanted socio-economic caste census. Nitya Rao is writing an article relating gender inequality with climate change. How climate change is causing more gender inequality. We have in the syllabus crisis of development, poverty, deprivation, inequality, violence against women. So these are some of the topics present in the syllabus which can be seen. Division of labor and patriarchy. What is happening because of the climate change? Because of climate change, livelihood, precariousness of the livelihood is threatened. Already women are burdened with domestic work. Climate change is affecting their health. Climate change is affecting their nutritional well-being and ultimately their survival. So gender inequality intensified or vulnerability of women got intensified because of the climate change. There is a symbiotic relation between women and nature. So women would be organically linked with nature. Women are dependent on nature for fuel, fodder, minor forest produce, so that they can make up a livelihood. But when this forest is depleted, when the resources are getting exploited because of the climate change, when the exhaustion takes place, then it is women who are more affected due to the climate change. Women's work burdens in production and reproduction, threatens their health, nutritional well-being and ultimately their survival. Solomon and Nitya Rao find how climate change is having gendered effects. All social groups, in all social group, fetching water is whose job? Women's job. So they have to go collect water if water is polluted because of the environmental degradation. They have to go collect biomass for cooking. So their survival is completely dependent on nature. Women's survival more dependent on nature. Due to climate change, men are migrating to cities. Because of climate change, agriculture is failing, so men are migrating to cities. And when men are migrating to city, all the burden will be on the head of the women. And that is why they are more vulnerable. Climate change triggers compulsory migration. Women are left in villages and their vulnerability therefore increases. When there is drought, then what is happening? If food is not there, then what will happen? Women will not eat food. So they will cut the food intake and that will definitely affect their health. So the last one to eat in the family is women. When there is a scarcity of food, when there is a drought, when there is a scarcity of food, then it is women who are more likely to get affected. Basanta Sahu study of food insecurity and women in Odisha. Food insecurity and women in Odisha, Basanta Sahu study. So the same topic you can take down. Agarwal found that poor families are finding it very difficult to cope up with the droughts and food insecurity because of the fall of agriculture. So how poor families are finding it difficult to cope up with the scarcity of food due to fall of agriculture and because of the drought? This is the topic of study by Agarwal. She found that gender and age formed the basis of intra-family inequality. Within the poor household, the burden of coping with the food scarcity is falling disproportionately on women, and women's bargaining power is reducing because of any calamity. So problem of agriculture is squarely affecting, disproportionately affecting women. They are finding it very difficult to cope up with the food insecurity, and their bargaining power is reducing when there is a natural calamity. Percentage of women participate in agriculture in India, but however they don't make any decision with respect to agriculture and they don't have access to resources or even ownership. They don't have no access, no ownership to land resources, no participation in the decision making. But if you look at 60% of rural women, they are into agriculture. Amartya Sen speaks about the notion of ownership. Not only you should be the owner technically or legally, you should have the sense of ownership. But there is no ownership, there is no access to land for women, and they don't have any decision making power despite of the fact that 60% of the rural women are into agriculture. So there is feminization of agriculture. Women are acting as food producers today, but they are facing some obstacles like uncertainty in the farm production, crop loss, etc. So feminization of agriculture, more and more women are into agriculture. Why more and more women are into agriculture? We have seen that when there is a distress, men migrate to city, nobody is there except women to lend their labor force to the agriculture. And also we are also seeing that there is a gender gap in the agrarian wage payment between the men and the women, that women are more chosen, more preferred, because the 30% wage is less for women compared to men. So it becomes economically feasible for the owners of the land to hire women workers. Next question is on Marxism and ecology. We know that how capitalism demands energy to run their industry, and to extract energy, what has to be done? Nature will have to be exploited. So energy can be extracted at the cost of environment. and there is an irreparable damage caused to the interconnection present in the forces of nature. We know that the ecosystem is having dependency, relationship of dependency between the organisms, right? So many, in fact, on one particular plant, 10 living forms will be dependent on. So there are 10 living forms, different types of living forms which are dependent on one single plant. If you are destroying the forest, then what will happen? The ecosystem is getting destroyed. So you can use this topic for environmental movement, Marxian perspective to understand science and technology. Science and technology and social change, how science and technology is used to exploit the environment, not to cause social change, but resulting in the loss of livelihood for the Adivasis who are directly dependent on forest for their livelihood. There is a concept which was used by Foster, F-O-S-T-E-R, and the concept is called as metabolic rift. What do you mean by metabolic rift? There is an irreparable damage caused to interconnection present in the forces of nature. UNFCCC says that by 2100, if we are not able to contain global warming to less than 2 degrees Celsius, there will be a catastrophic effect, there will be irreversible effect. Because what is hampered is the interconnection in the social process, in the natural process. Karl Marx speaks about what? Dependency. He speaks about how production is an act of cooperation. So environment is also having an ecosystem where there is a cooperation existing. The insect is dependent on the plant, the other animals or the other life forms are dependent on the insect. So there is an interdependency, but this interdependency is severed and there is an irreparable damage caused to the forces of nature. To refer to that irreparable damage caused to the force of nature, Foster is using a concept called as metabolic rift. So metabolic rift is nothing but Marxian concept of ecological crisis which will be looming large with the advent of capitalism. Capitalism demands energy, destroys nature, nature is, the imbalance is caused in the nature. So it is a irreparable rift in the interdependent process. It is an irreparable rift in the interdependent process of the social metabolism. Definitely environmental damage is causing alienation. Today we are living in a world where there is too much of advertisements. So we have seen how there is an alienation caused today, that there is a memes, selfies replacing our consciousness, self-consciousness. All these are science and technology, how it is causing alienation, how science and technology is used by capitalism to destroy the nature. So auto forwarding of advertisements, memes and selfies, we are having isolated faces in the crowd. These are the impacts of science and technology. People becoming machines. Ecological science says there are some tipping points, a trigger point which results in changes which cannot be reversed. So like if global warming is rising more than 2 degrees Celsius, irreversible damage happens, irreversible damages will happen according to UNFCCC. So these are called as tipping points. We are reaching this tipping point and we are going to experience from irreparable or irreversible damages. The tipping points are climate change, biodiversity loss, changes in the nitrogen cycle, phosphorus cycle, ocean acidification, crisis in land and freshwater use, atmospheric aerosol overloading, and chemical pollution. These are irreversible. These are the environmental damages which cannot be reversed. Loss of biodiversity, climate change, changes in phosphorus and nitrogen cycle, ocean acidification, crisis in land and freshwater usage, atmospheric aerosol overloading, and chemical pollution. They are the tipping points where there is no return. There is irreversibility. Change once happened cannot be reversed. So these are accelerated, these tipping points were accelerated because of capitalism. There is a concept or a perspective called as eco-Marxism. So this is nothing but dialectics. What is happening in capitalism? The need of capitalism is going to multiply. It is going to exploit the nature, and definitely everything will cater to the interest of the imperial forces, and definitely there is an exploitation of human labor as well as nature. So this is typically Marxian theory, that how forces of nature is only catering to the interest of capitalism. Exploitation, environmental degradation is a regular phenomena in capitalism. So what is happening? Because of the contradiction between the demands of capitalism and the nature, environment is degraded, and we have a problem which we will likely experience in future: planetary ecological collapse. So there is an imminent planetary ecological collapse. Apart from writing Marxian perspective applicable to environmental degradation, you have to use some concepts additionally, like metabolic rift and planetary ecological collapse. Planetary ecological collapse. Gender justice. No social recognition of women's work in the domestic realm. Christine Delpy says there are 56 types of works for which women are not paid. No right to residence available. Even when they go to husband's house after marriage, there is no right to residence. Because we have follow what? Patrilocality. Patrilocality means after the marriage, wife will have to go to the husband's father's house to live in. So it is husband's father's house, or it is husband's house, it is not her house, so there is no right to livelihood. And whatever right women have got today, it is not a comprehensive form of right, it is in a piecemeal manner that they have got right to custody of children, they have got right to divorce, right to inheritance. In different point of time, they were given different rights in a piecemeal manner, not comprehensively they have been given rights. So what law will have to be made by the state is gender just law. Gender just law will have to extend a comprehensive right for women irrespective of the caste or the religious distinctiveness. All women, here where we have to speak about uniform civil code, all women irrespective of caste, irrespective of religion, will have to be given gender just law. So this gender just law will have to be applicable even to transgenders, LGBTs. Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Guarantee Program is a very comprehensive social security legislation, beyond a doubt. But however, they are not given job in the marital home. So we have to amend the act to ensure that women staying in the marital home, they also have a right to employment. So supposing that women face problem in the married life, definitely they will be having some sort of livelihood if they are given opportunity to work in the Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Guarantee Program. So women in the marital home, they also should be accorded legal right to work. Supposing there is a dissolution of marriage, then they can continue to earn their livelihood through this Employment Guarantee Program. So we wanted a social security which is inclusive. Rural deprivation. So there is a concept of poverty, deprivation, inequality, paper 2, changing modes of production in Indian agriculture, and problems of rural labor, bondage, migration. These are the topics present in the paper 2 syllabus, and we can add these points. Already we spoke about the socio-economic caste census, and we are continuing with this in a new topic called as the problems of the rural community. Look at the socio-economic caste census. Landlessness plus dependence on manual casual labor, they are the two important deprivations faced by rural families. You are landless and you are dependent on manual labor. So these two are the most vulnerable form of deprivation faced by rural families: landlessness and dependence on manual casual labor for livelihood. How 7 indicators are used in this socio-economic caste census? These are the 7 indicators: household with a kacha house, household without adult member in the working age, women headed family without an adult male in the working age. So 7 markers of deprivation as per the rural census or the socio-economic caste census. Household with kacha house, not paka house, kacha house, no adult member in working age, female-headed households. Fourth is disabled member present in the family. Fifth is SEST houses. Sixth is illiterate. Seventh is landless engaged in manual labor. So this landless engaged in manual labor increases more and more vulnerability. 7 markers of deprivation as given in the socio-economic caste census. So if they are asking you about the types of deprivations present in the rural community or the village and deprivation, instantly you have to write about the socio-economic caste census. If you are deprived in more than one marker, then you are suffering from worst case of poverty. 30% of the rural people have minimum 2 deprivations. So 30% of the people are having more than one deprivation, or they have 2 deprivations. 13% have 3 deprivations. Only 0.01% suffer from all the 7 deprivations or handicaps. More and more deprivation, more and more poor. Only 0.01 is more poor. 48.5% of rural households suffer from at least one deprivation. Right? Already we have told landless engaged in manual labor, they are more vulnerable. 84% of people holding agricultural land, they are small and marginal farmers. 84% of the people owning land, they are small and marginal farmers. 54% of SCST household and female headed households without adult male member are also landless households. 54% of the SCST households and female-headed households without adult male member, they are also landless households. So, pauperization is a topic which can be dealt, which was already dealt in the Marxism. Farm sizes declining since 1970s. You look at the data. In 1970s, there was 2.2 hectares of land in average. But in 2010, it reduced to 1.25 hectare of land. So, the average size of land holding reduces from 2.25 hectare to 1.25 hectare, from 2.25 hectare to 1.25 hectare in 2010. Size of the land reduces, farmland. So there is more fragmentation of land, which we have already spoken about. Disabled children. How? Disability. Barnett says disability is socially defined phenomena. Disability is a social fact, not a physical fact. Disability is a social fact according to Barnett, 2005. So it has social consequences for the individual as well as the larger society. Durkheim speaks about social fact. If it is having consequences to the larger society, it should be called a social fact. Disability is having ramification for the larger society as well as for the individual. Hence only we say disability is a social fact. These are the problems faced by the disabled people: marginalization, exclusion. So they are excluded from health care, education, limited opportunity to play, no opportunity for cultural life, denial of family life, vulnerability to violence, poverty, exclusion from decision making. These are the problems faced by the disabled. Sociology of disability, if asked, you need to write this, that disability is not a fact, physical, rather it is social. Why? Because it is having not just ramification for the individual, it is having ramification for the larger society. The problems faced by the disabled are: they are excluded, marginalized, no cultural life, no play opportunity, no family life, violence, poverty, no decision making. Definitely, disability undermines self-esteem and self-confidence. And there is more loss of self-confidence and self-esteem, especially for girls with a disability, because it is a patriarchal society. A disabled girl is feeling more inferior. Her self-esteem is more reduced, undermined when she is a girl. Disabled girls have low self-esteem compared to that of disabled boys. World Health Organization says more females than male belong to both severe disability and moderate and severe disability categories. So, feminization of disability or feminizing disability. More women are more disabled, severely disabled than men. UNICEF says discrimination based on disability manifested itself in marginalization from resources and decision making. So this is UNICEF. WHO speaks about how more women are disabled, severe disability, moderate and severe disability suffered by women more than that of men. And UNICEF says how disability results in marginalization. UNESCO says school completion rate are lowest among children with disability, even when they are compared to other marginalized groups. So they are more marginalized than the socially marginalized groups. Disabled children, unable to go to school, they are not able to complete the school education. World Bank says children with disability in India are 5.5 times more likely to be out of the school than non-disabled children. More instances of children with disability out of the school compared to children without disability, according to World Bank. ...52% of adults with disability are illiterate, compared to 35% of general illiteracy. 35% of the general population is illiterate, whereas 52% of disabled people are illiterate. So more illiteracy present in disability. So what is needed is inclusive health, inclusive education. Inclusive health means it should be covering immunization, nutrition, water, sanitation, reproductive health, HIV, all these things will have to be comprehensively given for children with disability or those people with disability. So inclusive health is what the need of the time for the disabled people. Even the Election Commission of India was instructed by the Supreme Court of India that you have to provide ramp facility for those disabled population to cast their vote during the election. But nothing much has been done. Child marriage. Savina Chowdhury study in West Bengal. There is a conditional transfer, there is a conditional cash transfer scheme called as Kanya Shri Prakalpa. Conditional cash transfer scheme called as Kanya Shri Prakalpa in West Bengal to reduce the instances of child marriage. But what is happening is the incentive is not that much given, and that is why child labor, child marriage is not reducing. That is the problem. So this was hailed as a much needed intervention to combat high rate of child marriage in West Bengal. But whether it lived up to the expectation, definitely not according to Savina Chowdhury. According to National Family Health Survey 3, rate of child marriage in West Bengal was 53.3% compared to the country's national average of 40%. So 53% child marriage, 40% in India, 53% in West Bengal. 10 years after, in the National Family Health Survey 4, conducted in 2015-16, the rate of child marriage in India decreased to 26%, whereas West Bengal it is 40.7%. So which means that child marriage is not reducing in West Bengal despite of passing of 10 years, despite of the conditional cash transfer scheme, which was hailed as a much needed intervention to reduce the rising instances of child marriage. There was a study conducted out of 204 households in 4 districts where there was application of this or implementation of this Kanya Shri scheme. People were aware. It is not that people are not aware of the scheme. People were aware of the scheme, but very few got benefited. Only 5 out of 42 households availed this Kanya Shri benefits in South 24 Pargana. Why very few benefited despite of the fact that people were aware of the scheme? Small amount of benefit which is not sufficiently motivating people to avail the scheme. A very very small incentive will not motivate people. So incentive should be substantial for motivating the people. Small tokenism of incentive will not be of any use. Parents also find it very difficult if they over educate their children because they have to give high dowry So that is why they don't prefer girl education. Instead, they, rather than investing in the education of the girl, they are giving the money as dowry. Ethnic revivalism. So ethnicity, ethnic movements, ethno-nationalism. There is a Gorkha National Liberation Front, Gorkha land, demanding for Gorkha land, Subhas Gaising. He only popularized the term called as Gorkha land. During 1980s, this Gorkha movement became very radicalized. This Gorkha land became very radicalized. What they demanded was, Gorkha is not a weak community, Gorkha is a very strong community. We are soldiers. There is a Gorkha regiment. We are soldiers. Don't equate us to tribes. We are soldiers. So they wanted their culture to be protected. They wanted their identity to be preserved. So they were declaring that they should not be considered as tribal. Rather, they have brave tradition and civilization. And there is a need for Gorkha land. This will resolve the identity crisis for the Gorkha people or Nepali people present in India. Identity crisis. Identity crisis of the Nepalis in India can be resolved only by creation of a separate state called as Gorkha land. So it is an identity based movement. Gorkha movement is an identity or ethnicity based movement. In fact, Nepali kingdom blurred the distinction between the tribe and the caste. Rather, they were declaring all the lower caste as polluting caste. So those who were declared by the kingdom by polluting caste, they wanted upward mobility, for which they are trying to revive their identity. Unity was expressed by three communities in the Darjeeling Hill, Nepali, Bhutia and Lepcha. So they came together and went for Gorkha land agitation, because their identity will have to be preserved. Nepali, Bhutia and Lepcha community. They were the strong protesters for Gorkha land. So they are not asking one single identity. In fact, they have multiple identities. They have different caste identity. They have different ethnic identity. So it is not for a single identity. Rather, they are asking for multiple identities. In fact, pluralism, pluralist perspective of power says that every individual is having multiple identity. Gorkha land movement is not only a homogeneous struggle over single identity, but a heterogeneous contestation of diverse ethnic and caste identity. Many groups came together. No, Nepali is one, Bhutia is another community, Lepcha is another community. All of them coming together wanted Gorkha land. Doesn't mean that they wanted the same identity, one single identity. Rather, they wanted multiple identities to be protected under the banner of Gorkha land. So heterogeneous identity is what they demand, not just homogenizing identity. Middleton and Snyderman, they say that Nepal's king, Shah of Nepal or Rana, attempted to blunt the differences between tribe and caste. They wanted to declare the ethnic group in Nepal as impures. So those who are original inhabitants in Nepal, those Janjadis, were declared as polluting caste by the constitution declared in 1854, Mulki Ain, which was drawn from Dharma Shastra. So ethnic identity today, or ethnic regionalism today, or ethnic nationalism, ethnic federalism, which is demanded by the people of Nepal today, has its root in 1854 constitution, which was drawn from Dharma Shastra called as Mulki Ain. They wanted to declare all the lower caste group as polluting caste, all the ethnic group as polluting caste, excepting the royal clan. And this is how today also they wanted ethnic federalism, which was opposed by the Mao, which was opposed by the Nepali Maoist. The legal code, that is Mulki Ain, did not allow mobility. Even the panchayat policy declared that any discussion on inequality is illegal. The panchayat policy, which was introduced by the kings of Nepal, says that you cannot discuss inequality. If you discuss inequality, then it is illegal. And the constitution is not permitting mobility for the lower caste. Even discussion on inequality becomes unconstitutional or it is unlawful. And that is the reason for the resentment today. Middleton says, if you look at India, constitution is not defining any criteria for declaring people as scheduled tribes. So there is no constitutional criteria for declaring people as scheduled tribe. So that is why we don't know who is a tribe. But however, there are some committees which are defining criterion for tribes, like Lokur committee. You have to be a you have to have primitive triads, distinct culture, isolation, shyness of contact, backwardness. These are the criterion used for identification of tribes, Lokur committee says. But our constitution is not having any definition for or criterion to be applied for tribes. So you can use this in tribes. There is a topic, unit number 2 in section A of paper 2, tribes, social structure, there is a topic called as tribes. What are the problems of the tribe? Identity related issues. Who is a tribe? Who is able to influence the state in power? They can be declared as tribes. Virginius Kaka says that colonial administrator used the term tribe to describe people who were heterogeneous. Who were heterogeneous in physical and linguistic triads, their demographic size, ecological condition, regions inhabited, and levels of acculturation development. So, British defined tribes based on certain criterion. You should have diversified triads, linguistic triads, many dialects are present. And you should be living in geographically isolated area, you should be backward. We have tribe versus caste. There is a concept called as tribe caste continuum. So what are tribes, what are caste? Compare and you see how they are linking with each other or how they are interacting with each other. G.S. Gore speaks about which approach, assimilation approach. N.K. Bose speaks about Hindu method of acculturation. Verrier Elwin speaks about national park approach, and independent India wanted integration approach. So how caste is incorporating the tribe? Because of the technology. Caste is having high technology, they have settled agriculture, whereas primitive technology is with the tribes. So because of the technological advancement, that caste is trying to attract the tribes. Caste identity, tribal identity, ethnic identity, multiple identities are present, which may reinforce with each other. And we also have seen in ethnicity as a base of stratification, ethnicity cannot be properly defined, that it is a flexible concept. Frederick Barth says, the boundary of ethnicity is a variable. So interest, based on which you are using your ethnic identity to influence the configurations of power, structure and politics. So based on the configurations of power, structure and politics, you try to use your identity. If it is authoritarian, then there is a revival. If it is democratic also, there is a revival of identity, because democratic societies are becoming economically modern. Very manifestly prejudice is exhibited, which is called as explicit prejudice. People readily accept that they have prejudice. So there are two types of discrimination: overt discrimination and covert discrimination. In the topic on racism, in the class we spoke about institutional racism. Institutional racism means covertly through public policy you are inserting racial discrimination, which is not very obviously visible. But explicit prejudice means openly you admit that you have a prejudice against a particular community. Suppose if people are not openly accepting, they are practicing covertly. So prejudice is overt or covert. According to Sigdio Thorat, prejudice results in negative externalities with respect to occupation, education, economic and health outcome. In the last class, we discussed about how the scheduled caste, when they are experiencing upward mobility, even their doctors or the teachers present to scheduled caste, they are finding it difficult to rent a house. They are discriminated in the workplace. Right? Tribal children are not allowed to take up the role of Krishna or Rama in the play because they belong to untouchable. Chaudhary says Gungat or Gungat, which is a practice of women wearing the sari on their head to hide their, you know, face, is only speaking about gender based inequality, parda system. Palriwala is a sociologist. She says that women eat meals after men. This is present in most of the parts of the country. Women will eat after men, and this is discriminatory, speaking about women's unequal position in the society. Definitely, in a poor family, food is not present in the for the people who eat last. Food is not present for the people who eat last, and they suffer from malnutrition, which is why 60% of Indian women are suffering from malnutrition. Violence against women is the next topic. There is a survey conducted by Thomson Reuters Foundation, violence against women. India is the most dangerous country for women. India ranks below Afghanistan, Syria, Somalia, Saudi Arabia. So more violence in India than Afghanistan, Syria or Somalia or Saudi Arabia. With respect to what? Healthcare, economic resources, discrimination, sexual violence, non-sexual violence, human trafficking. These are the problems which women in India are facing more. Healthcare issues, access to economic resources, discrimination, customs, sexual violence, non-sexual violence, and human trafficking. These are the problems faced by women. Violence against women is a topic in your last chapter in paper 2, where you can use these points. Patriarchal society, intrinsic structures of discrimination, these are the keywords which you have to take down. Patriarchal society, intrinsic structures of discrimination against women and girls. So So patriarchy present in polity. Female journey is characterized by inequality and discrimination from the birth to death. Life of women is a journey of inequality from birth to death. Intrinsic structures of discrimination is a phrase which has to be used. Intrinsic structures of discrimination against women. Patriarchy rules the roost. Patriarchy rules the roost in our polity and society. Discrimination from birth to death. So female infanticide, female feticide, sex ratio, declining child sex ratio is an evergreen question asked in UPSC for 10 mark, where you have to write about intrinsic structures of discrimination against women and girls. Discrimination even before birth, not only from birth. Female feticide, sex ratio is shocking in Haryana. The law is not able to change the society. There is a topic called as law and social change. Law and social change, visions of social change, paper 2, law and social change. Preconception, prenatal diagnostic technique act is not able to change the mindset of the people. Metas and preference is a concept used in economic survey, which we have discussed in the test question. So girls continue to be killed in the womb. Dropout of the girl children. Family spend more on boys' education than girls' education. High instances of child marriage because of poverty. And it is also leading to poverty. Lack of income. Child marriage because of locked minds, conservative minds. So girl is seen as a liability, whereas boy is seen as an asset. This is a conservative mindset. Vicious cycle it is creating. No education, early marriage, early motherhood, domestic violence, and loss of earning capacity. And this is more so for the girls coming from lower caste, Dalits, minority, and those poor girls. So poverty, ethnicity, gender inequality, juxtaposing with each other. Juxtaposition of gender inequality, poverty, and minority. Very few women are influencing politics. Politics is characterized by omnipresent, dominant patriarchal forces. So this is a phrase which has to be written when they are asking about democratic decentralization or panchayat institution evaluation. Omnipresent, dominant patriarchal forces present in polity. Omnipresent and dominant patriarchal forces. I told you to maintain a list of jargons and keep reciting the jargons. Then only, without any conscious effort, naturally you think in terms of jargons. How in Kerala, tribes were branded as mentally ill. So tribal problems, violence against vulnerable section. Development perpetrates silent violence by stripping the sense of belonging through state and non-state interventions. So, perpetration of silent violence by development through state and non-state actors by stripping the tribes of their sense of belonging. all the problems of the tribes, systematic expropriation of tribal lands. Expropriation means in the national interest or in the public interest, the government is taking over, nationalization of tribal property, dispossession of land, loss of livelihood, displacement, exploitation, Michael Cernia, development induced displacement, 8 points I have told in the test batch discussion, which can be added to the problems of the tribes. The term which you have to use is systematic expropriation of tribal land. Legal violence against Adivasis. This is a phrase, a jargon, legal violence against Adivasis accentuated by predatory capitalism. So, today you have globalization without a human face. Capitalism is not having a human face. Dehumanization is caused by capitalism. Materialism is displacing humanism. And this is what is brilliantly explained by Karl Marx in his concept of alienation. Mortification of self. There was a question before, asked 2-3 years before. Mortification of self. The self is mortified, killed by capitalism. In Attappady is a place of study in Kerala. Tribes constituted 90% of population in 1950s. But it result, it is now 34% in 2011. In 1950s or in 1951, 91-90% of tribes were living in this Attappady village. But today it has plummeted to 34%. So tribal population is drastically reducing. Many of the tribes, they have to give their land to settle their loans, which they have taken, writing of their land to clear their loans and leaving the land. So they don't have right to self-determination, and they are development, in the name of development, they are robbed of their stake. So they are losing their right to self-determination, and development is robbing of their stake in the process of development. A mentally ill tribal man was beaten to death in Kerala. So how mental illness is a means of social control. Using mental illness, society controls a particular section. There was a mental health campaign. There was a mental health campaign which was taking place in the village. And after the mental health campaign, many people were estimated to be mentally ill after the campaign. So which means what? Systematically you are using this as a strategy to eliminate the population, to deprive of them the right to self-determination by branding them as mentally ill. Look at this. Community mental health programs resulted in structural violence and social sufferings among the tribes. So community health programs see structural violence and social suffering among the tribe as psychiatric disease. You are taking, robbing of from them their land, and they become mentally disturbed, and you say that they are mentally ill. The community health programs, they are seeing structural violence and social sufferings among the tribes as psychiatric disease. So if you are dispossessed of the land, if you feel disenchanted, if you feel alienated or isolated, then such people are branded as mentally ill. Dr. Ambedkar says, man is born not for development of society alone, but for the development of his own self. So declaring the tribal people as mentally ill when they are having a sense of frustration or social suffocation because of land alienation or indebtedness. Through the concept of mental illness, the society is trying to control a particular group and keep them perpetually enslaved to the dictates of the majority. So that is what is speaking about the vulnerability of the tribal community. So they are not able to see the subaltern group as a dynamic group. They are looking at the subaltern or the disadvantaged sections as a static group. Subaltern means victims of the vulnerable sections can be called as subalterns. Subaltern should be seen as a dynamic groups having their own need. You should not see them as static entities. Next is civil society. Why there is a need for civil society in democracy? Because it is only going to protect us from the despotism of the state. State excesses, if committed, then who will protect us? It is civil society. What is happening in democracy? There is a conversation between the citizens and the power elites. So those who are forming the government and those who are politically powerful, they have to talk to people, because then only they will get elected by the people in the next election. And what is done by civil society? Civil society is protecting people from the state arbitrariness. So civil society makes the society democratic, because it is preventing state arbitrariness. It is putting a check on the state arbitrariness. Otherwise, state will be more powerful to abuse its own citizens. But what is happening today is rootlessness, alienation. Modernity has actually weakened this civil society. So civil society today is silenced. Many people are arrested for speaking or criticizing the government. So dissent is discouraged in democracy. Civil society is repressed today. And what will happen? The government is trying to monopolize power. The government is losing its democratic component by crushing the civil society. So they are using their frontal organization to silence the civil society, or trying to occupy the space of civil society, political parties. Actually, in democracy, there should be present multiple layers which will link the people with that of the state. One is political party, another is civil society. But what is happening? Political party itself is running television channel. The news is not fair. Civil society is completely today controlled by political parties. Political party itself is having an outfit called as civil society. So they spread they become the mouthpiece of the political party in power. And actually, the civil society, which is present for protecting the people from against the state, they are arrested for criticizing the government under sedition law, or earlier under 66A, now 67 of Information Technology Act. So silencing civil society is dangerous to democracy. Civil society is a space which is left for public-spirited groups to make democracy vibrant. But today civil society is also controlled by the party in power. So state is going by the logic of power, market is deciding the profit, and civil society wanted to integrate people. But what is happening? They are silenced today. And if they are silenced, if they are repressed, if their voice of dissent is disagreed or it is suppressed by the government, then there will be incivility rather than civility, and there will be violence rather than non-violence. So silencing civil society is a danger to democracy. Silencing civil society will result in the emergence of incivility replacing civility. Violence replacing non-violence. So that is how civil society should be protected. So strengthening civil society will have to be cultivated. Solidarity is needed, civility is needed. Next topic is new vulnerability. Lynching. Non-state actors today are unleashing violence. So normally state is having two apparatus, a coercive apparatus called as repressive state apparatus and a persuasive apparatus called as ideological state apparatus according to Louis Althusser. So violence through coercive state apparatus or the repressive state apparatus. But today violence is not by the state, violence is by the non-state actors. Gaurakshas. Why there is a need for non-violence? Paul Brass finds the reason for Gandhian non-violence. Why Gandhi adopted non-violence according to Paul Brass? Gandhiji understood that India is a deeply divided society because it is a multicultural society. There are present fault lines already. Being a multicultural society, there is present fault line already. And hence, there are more scope for violence. There are more potentials for violence in India. So, when there is a natural scope for violence in India, natural potential for violence in India because of the nature of religious distinctiveness, he wanted to choose the path of non-violence because violence normally will get unleashed, for which there should be a counter institution called non-violence. So that is the reason why he chose non-violence, because India is having more potential for violence. So if there is a violence, then what we have to do? We have to use law. Law will have to play the role of an agent of social cohesion and social control. On one hand, law should result in social control. At the same time, law also will have to integrate people. Social cohesion and social control will have to be the twin purpose of law. Development. What is development? Development is expanding the capabilities of the disadvantaged people. That is what is development. Expanding the capacity of the disadvantaged people is called as development. So disadvantaged people will have to have a quality life. That what is development. We have to improve the quality of life of the disadvantaged people, and that only should be called as development. Maharashtra is a very progressive state. Maharashtra is an economically very progressive state, and there is a, and it is also a case of lack of development. Malnutrition is unacceptably high in case of Maharashtra, especially in the tribal belts. So it is not progress, it is not growth, but development which is needed. Maharashtra is growing economically, but there is no development. And that is what is manifesting in the name of increasing malnutrition among children, especially in the tribal areas. The per capita income of the state doubled since 2004. But however, the nutritional status has not made in commensurate with that of the economic development. So economic growth without any commensurate nutritional development. Consistently since 2004, state is progressive in its economic indicators, but not developmental indicators. In commensurate to the growth, there is no nutrition in Maharashtra. Acute food insecurity in the tribal households, loss of forest livelihood, and deepening agrarian crisis in Maharashtra. Acute food scarcity or food insecurity in the tribal households because of loss of forest livelihood and deepening agricultural crisis. So malnutrition unacceptably high in case of Maharashtra, food insecurity more in case of the tribal households because of the deforestation, because of the forest livelihood which is threatened due to capitalism and deepening agricultural crisis. Public institutions are becoming very weak, weakening of public nutrition programs. So we need institutions. 20% of tribal families could not receive rations because they don't have a card, identity card or ration card. In Vikramgad, Maharashtra, 20% of the tribes could not benefit from the PDS shops as they don't have ration cards. Next is right to education. There was a book written by Avinash Kumar Singh. Avinash Kumar Singh is writing a book, Education and Empowerment in India. He speaks about linkage between education and empowerment of the disadvantaged communities. There is a topic called as education and social change. So this is a book which came in the news recently, Education and Empowerment in India. Need not read the book, but you can write the book, name of the book, in Education and Empowerment in India, Policies and Practices. Avinash Kumar Singh speaks about how education is an instrument of social change. It can help in empowerment of the disadvantaged communities. 1940s and 50s, you have two different curriculums, one for the girls, another for the boys. So policy documents of 1940s and 50s say that differentiated curriculum for girls and boys. Education for girls reinforces the domestic role of them. And this was highlighted that how can you have two sets of curriculum? Girl education is more and more reinforcing the culturally stereotypical domestic role of women. And thereafter only they started introducing a uniform curriculum for both girls and boys. So gender inequality. In 1978, there was a report which says that we have to give more importance to girl education. They are economically productive. They can be economically made productive. So girl education was given a big push because of the 1978 report. Zoya Hassan says how due to lack of education, Muslim youths were unable to secure employment. They faced a difficulty in accessing education, and because of which they also find it very difficult to find an employment. So difficulty faced by Muslims to access education and employment highlighted by Zoya Hassan. Deepankar Gupta speaks about inadequacies in RTE Act, that it is not able to ensure quality education. The state burden is not that much. There is a very restricted burden for the state. And there is also no reservation for the girl children. in the 25% government seats which has to be filled by the children coming from poor families in all schools, including private schools. Deepening crisis in education can be seen from the fact that way back in 1966, Kothari Commission wanted 6% GDP to be spent on education. But today, how much we are spending? Less than 3%. Our growth rate has increased tremendously from 1966 onwards. So, there is a favorable economic climate, social climate for investing 6% of GDP on education. But still, we are not even able to spend 3% of GDP on education. The Trivankur king way back in 19th century was spending much on education. So he introduced universalization of primary education in Kerala in 19th century. That is what is one of the main reason for why Kerala is having highest literacy rate in India. The foundation was laid in 19th century. In Brazil, they spend close to 8% of GDP, 6 to 8% of GDP on education. That is why Brazil is able to provide a comprehensive social security for the people, because they spend more on education in comparison to military defense. So lack of spending on education is deepening the inequality in education. Growing inequality and dissonance are the consequence. Youth unrest. Youths are searching reason for protest. They are soldiers searching cause. And there is so much of dissonance, frustration present in the youth. Youth unrest is mainly because of the malnourished education system in India. Youth unrest is because of the malnourished education system in India. That more and more commercialization of education, resulting in education becoming the preserve of the rich. Earlier, education was the preserve of the Brahmins. Cultural groups were able to privatize education. Today, economic group is privatizing education. So caste is replaced by class today. Higher caste monopolized education before, higher class is monopolizing education today. That education is still a distant dream for many of the children coming from rural areas. If you look at tribal areas and inclusive education, so you can write in tribal problems. These points can be written in the tribal problems, inclusive education and tribes. Jean Rees and Sen say, among the Dalits and tribes, more and more school dropout, abstinence, poor participation in school. So highly tilted towards historically deprived sections like tribes and Adivasis, like tribes and Dalits. They are more dropping out of the school. They are unable to participate in the school. They are abstaining from the school. So abstinence, school dropout, and poor quality of school participation are historically tilted towards the education, the discriminated sections from the beginning. 94% of literacy rate is present in Kerala. But even in Kerala, there is no inclusive education for the tribes. Tribes are left out, even in Kerala. Kerala has achieved 94% of literacy. It also performs extremely well in other social indicators like health. But however, you see that according to Nitya and Menon, in their study 2013, found how Kerala historically failed to ensure the benefits of this education to tribal population. So even in Kerala, there is no inclusive education for the tribal people. Tribal students are engaging in the rural labor force. They are not coming to the school, they are going to the work. They are becoming child workers. So the state, which is a standing example for literacy development of, in fact, the progress in the development indicators, even in that state, the tribal education is not inclusive. Philip et al., Philip and others, they cite the reasons for increased dropout among the tribes and Dalits. Reasons are poverty, inadequate nutritious food, illness, scattered tribal hamlets far away from the school, cultural alienation in school curriculum, an inadequate number of teachers. These are the reasons for why tribal children are dropping out of the school education, according to Philip and others, 2015 study. Philip and others, in their 2015 study, cite the reason for why school dropout more present in the tribal children: poverty, inadequate nutritious food, illness, and physically they are far away, their tribal hamlet is far away as far as the distance is concerned. Cultural alienation, that the syllabus which is taught in the school is something which is alien. Their tribal heroes are not adequately glorified in the history books of NCERT. So national leaders are not coming from the tribes. Tribal leaders are not adequately represented in the history books. The role of the tribes in India's independence is not highlighted in the textbooks. So they find the curriculum is alien curriculum. It is not giving them the required skill set for them to lead a life in the tribal hamlet, and that is why naturally they are falling out of the school. Jose in a study found that tribal group affiliation acts as a source of discrimination for the tribal students at schools. So tribal students are neglected by non-tribal students. That is what you have to know. Non-tribal students don't include tribal students as their peer group. They are isolating them. They are not including them as their equal peers. Tribal children are isolated by the non-tribal children. Cowell in a study found that tribal children are afraid of talking about the unequal treatment they are facing in the school, because the teachers are coming from the dominant caste and they themselves practice untouchability. So tribal children are afraid to talk about the unequal treatment they face in the school, in the form of verbal abuse, physical punishment, and teachers are coming from the dominant caste. They themselves practice untouchability. So even they cannot report to the teacher, the teachers are themselves discriminating the tribal children, practicing untouchability. So that is why they fear to speak about the discrimination which they are experiencing in the schools. They are discriminated by their own peer group, they are discriminated by the teachers, and they are facing all types of unequal treatment in the schools. So tribal children are not invited by the dominant caste children to play with them, and definitely intermingling of the tribal children with non-tribal children becomes extremely difficult. So even when they come to school, they have to confine themselves, they have to isolate themselves, and there is untold discrimination sufferings which they are facing, and that is demotivating the tribal children to come to school itself. So a state like Kerala itself is not giving inclusive education for the tribes. Poor quality of the education system. Because of the poor quality of the education which the school is giving, tribes are not able to get a job. When they are not able to get a job after education, then the parents are not ready for sending the children to school itself. because rather than remaining unemployed by going to school, you can become a child worker. So increased unemployment because of the lack of quality education demoralizes others to educate their children. So by seeing the tribal child not able to get education, not able to get employment even after education, the other tribal parents are refusing to allow their children to go to school because of the fear that they'll also remain unemployed. So that is what is present. So what you have to do is systematic effort is needed to find out the reasons for the socio-cultural alienation. So why they are socio-culturally alienated? Based on the reasons, socio-cultural reasons, socio-cultural reasons for the dropout, we have to suggest the remedy. So inclusiveness is democracy. Pluralism is the fabric of Indian society. Not just tolerating the differences, embracing and cherishing differences becomes the hallmark of India's civilization and cultural heritage. So when you are discriminating based on differences, then that speaks about how Indian society is becoming anomic society, where there is pathology present, right?